Professor Naomi Kallas. Naomi is coming from University of Rice.
Rice University.
And she's a very great scientist, actually. She has not discovered 250 publications in very good journals, for sure. And she's very highly cited, incredibly highly, over 60,000 times. 60,000 times. Can you imagine?
No.
There are some scientists, even some professors, which are cited only 60 times. And for H indexes, at least 120. I don't know.
Yeah, but who's counting?
Some weeks ago, it was 120. And so, Naomi is... what is she doing? She is doing some different nanostructures, nanoparticles, and with some very specific functions.
That's why you invited me.
Explain us about some such nanostructures. And also one of most important of all inventions was the invention of some kind of nanoshells. Made out of glass and
whatever
by gold, so far as I understood.
Okay.
The description. And today Naomi will introduce us, will present us the presentation about light harvesting nanoparticles for cancer therapy and solar stem scheme generation. So Naomi, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So can everyone hear me? Hear me? So do I have to what? Do I have to use this? I can't move around.
I think you can take it like this.
Can I move around? Oh my God, that's difficult. I can't do that in a laser pointer. I'll drop both. I have a little jet lag, so that's fine. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. We'll make it work. So good afternoon. It's so nice to be here. It's really nice to be here. I've never been to Lithuania before. I'm so happy to be here. I've always wanted to go. I've always been so interested. I've known Lithuanian people my whole life, and so it's wonderful to actually see you in your native habitat. It's wonderful. So physicists, chemists, material scientists, bioengineers, the few, the proud. Chemical engineers, civil engineers. Just wondering where. Undergraduate? Oh, good for you. Graduate? Everybody else? Okay, postgraduate? Very good. I just wanted to know who I'm talking to. So thank you so much. I'm so thrilled to be here. And this is actually the oldest building at Rice University. And we're in Houston, Texas, which is the fourth largest city in the United States, and I think my battery just died, but so we'll just have to figure out how we can do this without a laser-free talk. Everyone talks about nano. We know about nano. We know about this, right? This is nanoelectronics or electronics. This is the 20th century, going from solid-state transistor I need something. Yeah, that's mine, and that died.
That's yours, and this died.
Yeah, this is mine. So let me put mine back, and let me try your driver, and we'll see if that works. Okay, it's an intelligence test for my computer. Okay. Let's put that on. Okay, so let's see if that, it's gonna have to, okay. Okay, so this is sort of a done story, right? You can't miniaturize electronics any further, so people are excited about quantum computing because you can't miniaturize electronics any further. But if we think about light, we can actually ask the question, how can we take photons, how can we take light that is of very, very large dimensions, right? Telescopes and so on, how can we take how can we miniaturize optics to the nanoscale? And one way to do that is with is going beyond the integrated optics of the latter 20th century, which brought us off optical fiber, telecommunications, and so on. To the nanoscale, we're using metals. And so this interesting little structure here is two silver spheres about 100 nanometers in diameter, and they're separated by about a 4-nanometer gap. And if I shine light on this structure polarized along the interparticle axis, I can concentrate light in this very, very small gap, and dimensions that are less than a hundredth of a wavelength of light. And so this is actually one of the most exciting potentials of metal nanoparticles in light, and why we're excited about the combination of light and metal particles. And that is such a, this is such a paradigm that this actually has a little nickname called a hotspot. And so that is actually a wonderful example of how one can actually use use non-dielectrics and their unusual dielectric function to focus light far, far below the diffraction limit. So metal particles are wonderful. Michael Faraday used to give lectures about gold nanoparticles. Gold nanoparticles don't look gold. Gold nanoparticles instead have a very different property. they absorb green light, and so they transmit the complementary color, so we see red light. And this phenomenon was actually was known phenomenologically before there were chemists, back when there were alchemists. This is a beautiful cup found in the British Museum and often found in high school chemistry books. that illustrates the beautiful optical properties of gold nanoparticles. And this was actually the first triumph of classical electromagnetic theory by Gustav Mie to actually describe why a sub-wavelength particle of gold with an incident plane wave and with the best measurement of the dielectric function they could possibly do back in 1908, why this particle actually absorbs green light and looks red and does not look the macroscopic color. So we're very interested in this idea, and we decided to do a very simple variation of this, and not start with a solid particle, but with a hollow particle, or at least electromagnetically a hollow particle, have something with a dielectric. Oh my goodness, my mother-in-law's online. Not a good idea. Okay. So, but I love her. Okay. So. Particles where now we have a tuning knob. We can control the relative size of the core and the shell. And we weren't the first people to think of this structure at all. Decades ago, people studied this nice spherically symmetric structure theoretically, and predicted that if you vary the relative size of the core and the shell, you can tune the plasmon to whatever wavelength you want. And so we set our sights on making this structure, and that became a wonderful focus of our work for a great many years, both the fundamental science of how this works, which I'll explain to you in a moment, and also some of its applications. So people are very interested in plasmon resonances. So when I say plasmon resonance, what am I talking about? I'm talking about the collective electronic oscillation of delocalized electrons in a metal. These days that can extend to any material like doped semiconductors, even molecules with delocalized electrons in their orbitals, in a partially filled orbital, can have a plasmon, believe it or not. But today we're just going to talk about metals. So if I have a little sphere of gold, then the electrons will slosh back and forth. I can think of it as a simple harmonic oscillator, a simple classical harmonic oscillator. And this will absorb at a well-known resonant frequency. If I stretch the particle and it's no longer a sphere, but it's a rod, then what would I have? I would have two resonant frequencies. I'd have electrons that oscillate along the longitudinal axis. They'd have a lower energy, and electrons over here, and electrons that oscillate on the transverse axis, and they'd have a higher energy. And that's what chemists can do. Right? So if you're not a chemist, you're a physicist, and you don't like all that chemistry stuff, you can go to the clean room And you can make a little structure, like a little square, and you would find that you would have a resonance very much similar to what you would have, what you would have made in a chemistry lab, downshifted because now it's sitting on the substrate. And if you then make a little different structure that looks kind of like a rod, you would find, in fact, you have the same properties, again, shifted by substrate and broadened by the fact that it's multicrystalline. So this is actually one of the reasons why plasmonics is a field that has really taken off across multiple disciplines, because the same physics is there, independent of the different approaches that you might have for fabricating structures, but you can see that there's the similarity is there and is robust and has attracted many people into this field. So what happens if we bring particles together? So I have two particles, two gold spheres, and I bring them together. So I can think of that, as I just said, just describe one structure as being like an oscillator. If I bring two together, I can have a classical picture where I can think of them as basically two coupled oscillators. And the quantum analog of that is if I think of these as wave functions. So if, say, I have instead of having a gold sphere, I have a hydrogen atom, okay, one s orbital. So a hydrogen atom with its atomic states. If I bring another hydrogen atom next to it, well, what happens? Well, the two wave functions will mix and hybridize and form instead molecular orbitals, which will have a completely different set of energy levels. And so we can think of this picture as being directly analogous to what happens when we have plasmon. So if I have one gold sphere and another gold sphere, and they have a well-defined energy. I showed you that plasmon resonant energy already. It absorbs green light. If I bring the two together, then I form a coupled system where I have basically a whole new set of states, and they looks a lot like a diatomic molecule. There's actually a rigorous analogy between a simple quantum system and what this spheres with maybe 10,000 delocalized electrons are doing. And so we call this plasmon hybridization because it looks just like wave function hybridization, and it is actually the classical analog of wave function hybridization. But it is rigorous down to the quantum level. If you solve the Schrodinger equation for 10,000 electrons, you would actually get this. You would get this same exact result. And so because this is so similar to molecular orbitals, I can call these two new states a bonding plasmon and an antibonding plasmon. And so I drew these little arrows to show you how the oscillations are actually happening, so we can then invoke the simple classical picture of two coupled pendulums, right? They're going to couple in phase or they're going to couple out of phase. And those are the two solutions to that. To that particular structure. So they look like a diatomic molecule. We call them dimers or artificial diatomic molecules. And they have a wonderful property that you can see very easily. If you go into the lab, if you just take a solution of gold nanoparticles, it looks red to the eye. And that would be these individual particles here. You bring them together, you're going to see a very different states. You've redshifted this mode in energy. This mode does not absorb light. These are out of phase oscillations. It doesn't couple to the electromagnetic field. This one does, okay? And it absorbs red light, so it looks a complementary color. It looks blue to the eye. So you have basically a very dramatic red-blue color change when the gold nanoparticles come together. And this is the fundamental mechanism behind the world's first plasmonic device. Now, this is a device that many of you have used. You can go to a pharmacy and you can buy this device. So I'm going to ask you, what could this device be? Some of you are probably smiling already. Some of you know this already. Very good. So it's a fluidic device, and I'm going to measure some molecules in a fluid, and so these molecules that I want to detect are flowing down the fluid. They reach this first region, which is pink, because I have gold nanoparticles with little antibodies that are going to recognize this analyte, and they're going to flow again down the channel, having captured this analyte, until they get to the second channel, where there's a bunch more of antibodies, and so of gold nanoparticles with their antibodies attached, and they're going to find them, and they're going to form little dimers. And as we just learned, the dimers are not red to the eye; they are in fact blue to the eye. So what is this? Some of you are smiling. It's a home pregnancy test. So. Very likely you'll use one of these, or one of your friends will use one of these at some time in their life. And so this is why, so the sensitive ones are blue, because they're not based on molecules, they're based on gold nanoparticles, which have a much larger absorption cross-section. So they allow you to detect this change much earlier. So the very early pregnancy tests are all based on gold nanoparticles. So what can we do with this idea of plasmon hybridization? Well, we can use this to design a whole bunch of new and interesting nanoparticles of different shapes. And the shapes we make, not randomly, we make based on our understanding now of how plasmons mix and hybridize. And so I'll just show you an assortment of them. And because there's no nomenclature for nanoparticles, we get to name them whatever we want. And so we can name them very funny names. And so since I work at Rice University, it would make sense that I would make a nanoparticle based on the name of my employer. You remember one of the great accomplishments in nanoscience is when Don Eigler wrote IBM in helium atoms, right? So there's a tradition of naming something after your employer. So we have Nano Rice. We can also make structures that look like the semi spheres. We call them nano cups. People in Lithuania, you know Russian, right? So I don't even have to tell you what that is. Okay, that's a nano shell around another nanoparticle. you can't buy those in the airport. You can also extend this to coupling of nanowires to each other, or nanoparticles to nanowires. You can make structures that look remarkably like heteronuclear diatomic molecules. You can also make structures that look like that out of materials other than metal. So graphene supports plasmons and supports voltage-tunable plasmons. You can dump more electrons in with a bias voltage, and you can tune graphene plasmons all throughout the infrared. We can make structures that look like more complex molecules and all have their very well-established set of modes. Nanoshells, as I mentioned, and then more recently we've started to think about how we can leave the world of gold and silver and move into some more sustainable materials like aluminum. And so these are actually some aluminum nanoparticles that we made very recently. So I mentioned nanoshells before, so we can use this picture of plasmon hybridization, this paradigm, this concept, to describe why these are tunable particles. And so if we think about this structure, we can conceptually deconstruct it as basically a sphere and a cavity. And so if we take the sphere and the cavity as our primitive modes and we mix them together, we have something like a shell. And we would then have two hybridized plasmon modes. One of them will couple very strongly to electromagnetic wave, one very weakly to the electromagnetic wave. And so it's the lower energy feature, the lower energy feature here that couples to that couples to light and gives us a tunable absorption that goes from the visible into the infrared as one makes the shell thinner and thinner and thinner, which makes most sense because as the shell gets thinner, then the interaction between the surface, the sphere, and the cavity within our shell gets stronger and stronger. And that's what gives rise to this particular effect. So I'll say more about nanoshells later. One of the things that they're really, so the question, so we make them, okay, what are they good for? Good question. So they have very nice resonances. It's very easy to put their resonance in the near infrared, around 800 nanometers, just to the red of what the eye can see, for those of you who are not optical in nature. And this is a very important region of the spectrum, at least for bioengineers, it's a very important region of the spectrum. This is a region where we are the most transparent. After all, we are big bags of water, right? So water is mostly transparent in this region. That means we are as well. And so what we can do in this particular region, we can take our nanoparticles and make them very strongly absorbing right in this region where our tissue is the most transparent. So it's sort of like having a window. We can actually put a remote controlled particle, something we can control by near infrared light, somewhere in the body, and we can actually use the fact that light transmits through the body yet is absorbed by nanoparticles to do some interesting things, and so to do cancer therapy. So this is an illustration of how that works. So you take nanoshells as I've just described them, and you have to have a mouse with a tumor, and then you inject the nanoparticles not into the tumor, but you inject them into the tail vein, and they circulate throughout the animal. And very gradually, so there's nothing special attached to the nanoparticles at all. You just have a polyethylene glycol coating, a little coating that restricts how much they stick to capillary walls, for example. So they're not recognized by proteins. There's no immune response to the nanoparticles. They're not recognized by the immune system. And over several hours, they will take up naturally within a tumor site. Why does that happen? It happens because tumors grow their blood vessels, their vasculature, very, very rapidly. You know, they metabolize faster than normal cells. And they grow their blood vessels to feed this rapid growth. But they grow it in a very chaotic manner. So there's sort of dead ends, there's all this disorder where the blood vessels are formed. And so it's very easy for particles that are about 100 nanometers to get trapped within the tumor vasculature. And people have known about that for decades, actually. People use that for drug delivery into tumors, chemotherapy drugs, since the 1970s. So it's a well-known effect. It's called the enhanced permeability and retention effect. And so if you wait 12 hours until the particles are taken up in the tumor, and then you just shine near-infrared light through the skin into the tumor. And this is a mouse. This is a mouse on the day of treatment with a subcutaneous tumor. And this is the day of day 12 after the tumor is just irradiated for a few minutes. And you can see between day 0 and day 12 that the tumor is completely in remission. This is just a little scab or, you know, just a little damage to the surface, to the skin surface that sloughs off after about day 14. So we did this actually quite some time ago, 2003. It's taken a long time to get through FDA approval. I can say some more about that later. But then about 5 years ago, this entered the clinic. And this is something, if this makes you queasy, then don't look. This was the first human patient who had a tremendously disfiguring tumor on his neck. And so this was actually here. It was treated, and this was actually the first successful treatment of a human case of tumor remission. So we started a company. The company is called NanoSpectra Biosciences, and as I mentioned earlier, it exists. So I don't want to show these pictures of people, but we can see pictures of dogs. Right? Dogs are wonderful. There's a network of eight veterinary hospitals where they are treating dogs. So this little gal, her name is Okui, and she's being treated at the University of Georgia in Athens, Georgia, which has a big veterinary facility. And you can see this really nasty tumor on her leg. Dogs often get tumors on their appendages, and they're really they're very, very difficult to treat, if not impossible to treat. When you see a dog with an amputated leg, it's often because of a tumor that was on the appendage. So this is how this type of therapy is done actually in practice, and I'll explain why later in my talk. So basically, rather than just shining light through the skin, they infuse the nanoparticles they take up in the tumor site, and then they come in with fiber optic probes, and they insert the probes all throughout the tumor volume to make sure that all of the light is all the nanoparticles are exposed to light. And then we can see actually within a month, you see this wonderful just complete tumor remission. So there's a lot of excitement about this sort of treatment, and I'll say more about that later. So when we first started working on this, people were very interested and very excited about this. And then always someone in the back of the room would ask me this question: Can nanoshells be used for solar energy? And I used to scratch my head and say, well, maybe someday we'll figure out some way to do that. And so we started thinking about that a few years ago. And so we started to do a very interesting experiment. So you know how to make steam, right? Everyone knows how to make steam, right? How do you make steam? You make steam the way I used to make steam. You make steam, and I still make steam this way, right? I take a volume V of water, and I put heat underneath it, and then I wait a long time, right? Because it takes a lot of energy to raise the temperature of water, and then you have the enthalpy of vaporization. But eventually, I will make steam. But if I'm too impatient, I can do it another way, and I can take my volume of water, and I can put in light-absorbing nanoparticles. I can shine light on it. That could be a laser light. It could be sunlight. I'll show you examples of both. And I would make steam right away. And just to be fancy, I could make steam. Oh, very high efficiency. I could actually make it if I put the whole thing in an ice bath. So I'm going to show you that in a moment. So this is an interesting, very sophisticated experiment. I'm going to show you if I have nanoparticles and I say I shine a laser at the wavelength that the nanoparticles absorb and I just put them on an analytical balance and I measure the mass loss, then I'm measuring basically how much steam is produced. And if I have particles on resonance versus particles off resonance, I would see this very simple mass loss. So we're going to use that very sophisticated method later in my talk. So now I'm going to show you exactly what I described to you, and that is how you can make steam how you can make steam without boiling water. So I'm going to show you a video, but the video goes fast. So to explain the video, I have to show you what's going on. So we have a test tube full of with water that is filled with nanoparticles, light-absorbing nanoparticles. We have a little block of oil on the top just so we can see what's going on. We stuck a thermocouple in the bottom so I can measure the temperature increase. I put the whole thing in an ice bath, and then I shine focused sunlight on the nanoparticles, and I'm going to see steam generation. So let's see if this works. There we go. Okay, this is the thermocouple here. This is a timer just for dramatic effect. And so here's my little simple test tube. I focus sunlight. Very quickly, I see that I made steam, and I made steam in a very short period of time, and the thermocouple still reads zero. Okay, so how does that work? Okay, so we can do this experiment again. So we don't use solar simulators, just so you know. I live in Houston, Texas, and Houston has the same latitude as Cairo, Egypt, so I'm so much further south than you guys. Okay. So we get a lot of sunlight. So the southwestern United States has a lot of sunlight. So we have so we can easily do a lot of outdoor experiments. So it's much easier than having to get a solar simulator. You just go outside. So you can see our very sophisticated laboratory. We have our lab chairs out here and our lab bench there. So what am I showing you here? I'm showing you a solution of nanoparticles in a test tube. There's a thermocouple in the bottom, and they are sitting on an analytical balance. Remember, I explained to you that experiment before. So now I can measure the temperature increase of the fluid, and I can measure the mass loss at the same time. So I can measure both how much energy is consumed by by heating the liquid, and how much energy it goes directly into vaporization of the water. So I can do this with different types of nanoparticles, and as long as they're broadband absorbers, it doesn't really matter which type of nanoparticle. So say I can illuminate my experiment, and I have two different volumes of the experiment. Obviously, the energy is going to be the heat capacity times delta T for the whatever mass of the water I'm using. So for over a given 4-minute window, for a larger mass, I have a smaller temperature increase. For a smaller mass, I have a larger temperature increase, right? And it's linear. It doesn't. Those little glitches are because the sun moves, and so we have to move our big fancy Fresnel lens here. We have to move this in order to follow the line. So when I look at how much steam I generate, it's independent of the mass, completely independent of the mass. And then if I look at how much energy is consumed by either process, what I find is that the energy that it takes to produce steam, so more than 80% of the energy goes directly into steam generation, and less than 20% goes into fluid heating. So what in the world is going on? So when we first did this, when we first reported this, we thought what was going on was that here we have our nanoparticles, and they absorb sunlight, and then they form some sort of a bubble around themselves, and then they rise to the surface, and this bubble through buoyancy is released. But the story is much more complicated than that. If we look more carefully, and we actually look at the numbers, and we look at how much heat is absorbed, so let's think about this now, okay? Let's think about this in terms of heat transfer. I have a gold nanoparticle, and it's sitting in water. That's a water bath, okay? What's going to win? The water bath's going to win, right? The temperature's not going to, the surface of the nanoparticle would not be heating up without, I mean, basically this heat is going to be dissipated by the water bath. That's what water baths are good for, right? And so if I look at the actual numbers for this experiment and I calculate what the temperature increase should be at my nanoparticle, I find absolutely ridiculously low number, okay, less than a tenth of a degree. So that's certainly not consistent with what I'm seeing. So what could be going on? And we weren't the only people to see this. So this wonderful group at MIT, Gong Chen, who's sort of the guru of heat transfer, was writing a paper with Svetlana Borskina and Hadi Gassemi about really looking at bubble formation. When you shine a bright laser on a nanoparticle, you can make bubbles. That's very easily done. We've done some experiments with single nanoparticles to watch that bubble formation. And when we did it, we began to realize, this is very interesting, we needed about 100 times more power than what we were actually delivering in our solar experiment. And so they wrote this really wonderful article, and they wrote this interesting sentence here. The puzzle is that the theoretical estimate of the nanoparticle temperature rise in 25, okay, that's us, is based on the calculation of absorbed power and the solution of the Fourier law heat conduction equation, is only 0.04 degrees Celsius. So what could be going on? And it turns out what we're seeing is a very interesting collective effect, and it's something that is actually, it's related to some very elegant physics. And it doesn't have anything to do with individual nanoparticles. One can make bubbles around a nanoparticle, but you do need, as I said, you need about more than two orders of magnitude more power to do so. And so what are we seeing? So let's think about this. So so what do we have in our solution? We have a solution of particles that do two things. These particles both scatter light and they absorb light. And so if I think of this as individual photons coming down, so this is basically a cuvette of solution and a laser beam incident from the top, just like the sunlight, but here it was just monochromatic. And so what's going to happen to each individual photon? They will encounter a particle, and they may scatter, encounter another particle, scatter. And eventually they'll get absorbed, maybe not at the first particle, but eventually they will get absorbed. And so this regime where you have both scattering and absorption of light, it turns out, is a regime where both physicists and chemists have avoided this regime. So there's a wonderful, a beautiful phenomenon called Anderson localization of light. And people study Anderson localization of light. It has some characteristic properties like coherent backscattering and so on. And one of the things you must do if you're going to study Anderson localization of light, you must work with scattering particles that are do not absorb light. If they absorb light, then you cannot observe that phenomenon very accurately. But we need to be work. Absorption is what makes this whole phenomenon work. So now we're in a regime where we have to look at particles that both scatter and absorb light. And so the only way to do this, we can't take any approximation, is to do Monte Carlo simulations of each photon coming down. And after we do several hundred thousand photons, we get a good idea of how they would scatter off of particles that would be that are in solution. So what am I showing you now? I'm showing you the theoretical calculation of particles that have an absorption and a scattering cross-section that we know, because we control the particles, those properties very accurately in this experiment. And I increase the concentration of those nanoparticles. They're actually nanoshells, so I can control all those properties. I increase the concentration, this is particles per ml, by an order of magnitude and another order of magnitude, and I look then, I detect in my simulation the light that scatters out the front of the face, as if I were going to go into the lab and take a picture of the light scattering out. And so I see an interesting effect. I see that basically the light is concentrated close to the liquid vapor interface, and I even see this coherent backscattering, which is in fact a signature of Anderson localization of light. So we take this simulation. Okay, the simulation was done before any experiments, and we said, well, with this simulation, I should be able to do exactly this experiment, take a photograph, and see something that looks remarkably like this, like the simulations. And in fact, we did. So this is the same type of concentration, same scattering cross sections and absorption cross sections for the particles, and we see, in fact, precisely what's going on. So now we can take that same calculation and look to where the energy goes.
So where does the energy go? This is the same calculation, but rather than looking at the photons that scatter out towards the camera, I'm looking at where the photons actually get absorbed. And as I go up in concentration, I find that I can actually, basically, this is a light trapping effect. It's a light trapping effect where we have multiple scattering, but in the presence of absorption, all the energy gets coupled very, very close to the liquid-vapor interface, which is where we want to heat the water if we want to make steam and not heat the volume. Of course, we want to heat it there. We don't want to heat it down there. We've been doing it the wrong way, right, for thousands of years. So this is just a histogram of how many scattering events before absorption. And so then when we take this as our heat source and do the heat, solve the heat transfer equation with that as our heat source, we in fact can reproduce really beautifully exactly the ice bath experiment. So we can actually see, you know, we can take a cuvette, and with an infrared thermocouple, we measure the temperature at the top, we measure the temperature at the bottom, and of course at the top we see the temperature go up with laser irradiation, and at the bottom there's no light getting there because all the light's being trapped right at that interface, and it's enough, it's concentrated enough that it's generating steam, and we see this very nice agreement between simulation and experiment with really no adjustable parameters at all. So what does this have to do with cancer therapy? Well, cancer therapy, we're talking about, I mean, there's many, many cases in the world that are absorbed in the real world, not the physics lab, the real world, that that involve both scattering and absorption of light. And tissue is highly scattering. And so here we're taking nanoparticles which we already know both absorb and scatter light. And if we think about what actually would be happening within a tumor volume, that exact same optical property is going to happen within a tumor volume. And so if I if I look at this as a calculation and I make my sphere, right? So the physicists always joke about spherical chickens. Do they joke about that, spherical chickens in Lithuania?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course. It's a universal mark of physicists. So here's my spherical tumor. And if I look at this, if I look at the tumor and I change the nanoparticle concentration, I find what bioengineers like to call a Goldilocks problem. They have too few scatterers here. The light passes through. They have no heating. They have too many scatterers here, and they have coherent backscattering. And then for this concentration, they have a region where they can actually have significant heating. So then how does one avoid this? Remember I showed you when one actually treats a tumor, they go in with many fiber optic probes and they actually probe direct light right into the tumor. So if you're not trying to shine light from above, but you're actually shining light from fiber optics that go in, that are distributed around the tumor and actually penetrate the tumor, then you actually can solve the optical the optical scattering problem that is characteristic of this. So the final story about cancer therapy has to do with prostate cancer. So it turns out that this is a huge problem, right? There's a huge patient population. These are numbers that are probably very scary to you. They're scary to me. My father was a prostate cancer survivor, and the CEO of this company is also a prostate cancer survivor. prostate cancer is usually treated if somebody has the genetic predisposition for this or the history within their own health history for prostate cancer. Then this is usually monitored by active surveillance, which means that they just check for it every 6 months to see if the PSA level is increased. And so the typical way this is treated is with radiation as the first step, and radiation and surgery, and then if things are really have moved outside to latter stage, then chemotherapy is a last resort. And so what the prostate oncologists now are beginning to realize is that rather than using radiation as the first step of treatment, Can we use nanoshell-based therapy, which they call, that's the commercial name, oralase therapy, as the first line of defense before one gets to radiation treatment? And so there's a human study with four different sites, two in New York City, one in Houston, and one at the University of Michigan Medical Center that have been taking patients since January. And they see that this is very, very promising. And just to show you this is some information from the company. So with focal therapy, that's oralase therapy, the type of treatment, the complications after treatment are really, really minor. There are no permanent side effects, but permanent side effects happen for the majority of patients under conventional radical treatments. So we're extremely excited about the possibility. Okay. Let me switch gears for a minute. So we've been talking about scattering particles and absorbing particles in the context of heating. Let's ignore the heating for a minute, because this is a very interesting optical effect. Okay, let's just talk about light scattering and imaging. So if I have fog, okay, and I'm trying to look through the fog, okay, what happens to the photons? They go from the object to the image, or from the scene, right? This lovely little bucolic scene to my eye, and they will encounter scatterers, right? And there will be some photons that pass directly through this medium of scatterers, and those are the ballistic photons, right? And so the ballistic photons will actually help me get an image, right? But the scattered photons won't, right? They'll detract from the image. But what happens if I add absorbers to my scatterers? So the probability that a photon gets absorbed is going to be proportional to its optical path length. So the ballistic photons are less likely to be absorbed than the ones that scatter light, because they have a longer path length. Okay. So do you believe that? It actually works. It makes sense. That makes sense. So let me show you. It actually works. So here we did an experiment where, so we're trying to resolve images here. We take three different types of scatterers. So these are just polystyrene spheres, they're scatterers. And they and then we add an absorber. Here we add a dye. No, we're adding carbon black to this, not a dye. And so you can actually see, if you resolve the spatial frequency, that shows us what our actual image resolution is going to be. So for water, it's very high, okay? And for this is clear up here. And for a scatterer without absorption, it's very, very low. But as I begin to increase my absorption, I begin to increase my ability to resolve the image. And it, very interestingly, it depends on the type of scatterer. If my scatterer is really small, then this is a big effect. If my scatterer is really big, then it's actually a really, really small effect. And that's unfortunate, because a lot of the things that we'd like to see through that are scattering media, things like tissue or fog, which are water droplets, those are actually really big scatterers relative to a wavelength of light, which is the metric we need to think about in terms of what the actual phase function is for the scatterer. So a dipole scatterer that's very small will get very, very much suppressed by absorption. But a forward scatter, like tissue, not very much at all. But it's interesting. Okay, so let's go back to what are some interesting things we can do with this solar steam idea. So the first thing we did, well, we know we can make hot energetic steam. And so we built this really funny looking thing. It's ugly, but we really like this. So let me tell you what this application is. So this is an autoclave. So an autoclave is something that you can use to sterilize glassware if you're in a biochemistry lab or a molecular biology lab, whatever. So what this is, so if you put hot energetic steam onto a surface, you can basically sterilize it. And we know we can make hot energetic steam if we just put our nanoparticles in a volume and we put in a solar collector. But this is designed for, this really simple prototype is designed for medical missions. So people who go on missions to developing countries, 90% of the weight they take with them on a medical mission are the chemicals that they need to sterilize their equipment, whether it's medical or dental equipment. So we can think of dental instruments, for example. it's very much a limiting factor in terms of how many patients you can treat, is how much chemicals that you have to bring with you, because they're not otherwise available. And so this is basically a portable, standalone type type of unit that would allow anyone to basically sterilize sterilize chemicals. And so another aspect of this, so sometimes this is another queasy topic, but but we'll get through it, is that if we can sterilize dental instruments, we can also sterilize human waste. And that's a huge, huge problem, and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is really focused on this as an issue that's just extraordinary in the developing world, and it's completely unessential. So these numbers really tell us an amazing story that people, so many people on our planet, do not have a good way to dispose of their waste. And the sad thing is that this means that that waterborne illnesses, which kill more than 1.5 million children every year, are prevalent. And so they've been very interested in, are there simple ways in which we can look at sterilization of human waste. So there's a company that was based out of MIT called Sanergy. And so they have a franchise model in Nairobi, Kenya, which has no civil infrastructure in terms of civil engineering, that people own, and they charge people to use their very fresh and wonderful latrines. So this is something, my goodness, we take advantage, we completely take advantage of the fact that we don't have to worry about things like this, but these are actually a very attractive business model. And then this company, Sanergy, which sells these as franchise units, they then have they go and collect the waste, and then they purify the waste. These two people are working in a distribution center that purifies the waste, and the idea is if you can purify it, you can use it as fertilizer, and fertilizer is really expensive, and so they're very interested in this. So we built for them a very simple solar steam unit. This is not the precise one that we sent to them, but this is this model that we built before that, with the basic idea that this would basically sit in one of their intermediate distribution centers, and the solar steam that's generated by this unit actually can be used to then to batch-wise treat human waste. So they're now operating this and seeing how this works. The reason this is important is if you don't use this and you have to go back onto the electrical grid, and it costs a lot of money to do what we can basically do for no cost with this. So that's actually what their interest. So making steam is fun, but making whiskey is more fun. Right? Am I right? Or vodka? Okay. So just as I showed you that we can vaporize a pure liquid, we can try to vaporize a mixture of liquids, and we can see what happens. So it turns out this is also one of these really big energy problems, okay? And this is a hidden energy problem. So I live in a part of the world where there's a huge chemical industry, of course, related to hydropetroleum and so on. But there's a huge chemical industry in Texas. And the major huge energy sink for all the chemicals that get made is distillation. So you can make chemicals, but as you know, anyone who's run chemical reactions, you make several different products, and you have to separate them. So separation is what costs an extraordinary amount of money. So if you look at just sort of the numbers, so these are all U.S. numbers, but you can see that the cost is really absolutely extraordinary just for separation. No alternative technology exists. And if you just use the example of bioethanol, okay? So bioethanol is a good example because it's just like making whiskey, right? So, and I'll talk a little bit more about this, or vodka. I'll say vodka for the purposes of my local audience here. So so basically, it's like you take a feedstock like sugarcane or corn, and you ferment it using yeast until the yeast dies, right? So you get to like the 9%, 10% level, right? And then you distill that, and then from that you get the ethanol. And so that's exactly how bioethanol that you put in vehicles is made. And so if you look at this actual cost of making bioethanol, roughly on the order of 75% of the energy costs go into this one process, which is distillation. So the cost is very large, but in the States we subsidize this because it's required to put in our gas tanks. So let's go back out to our outdoor laboratory and let's see what we can do. So we put light absorbing nanoparticles in our little distillation apparatus with a little condenser. And we're going to see how much a distillate we get off. And when we compare this to the same process without nanoparticles and heated with a solar source, we found right away this was very interesting little qualitative measurement that we get, seem to get a lot more distillate off much faster than we did for a thermal distillate. So it seemed like a more efficient process. But what was really neat was the fact that it really differed as a process relative to when we just do conventional thermal distillation of ethanol. So this is probably familiar to many of you from your high school chemistry books. So this is the distillation curve of ethanol. So if you go up to like 90%, then you can't distill anymore. They don't separate. So this is called an azeotrope. And this has caused lots of problems. You can't make dry ethanol, right? You can't get all the water out. So then we did our experiment with solar, and then we did our experiment dry in a laboratory with laser. We found that right away we get out much more of a drier fraction, a much more ethanol-rich fraction of ethanol. In fact, the azeotrope seems to actually disappear. And I have to tell the story about this. So the person who, the brainchild of many of our distillation experiments is a research scientist in my lab, and her name is Awara Newman, and she's from Israel. She's from Romania via Israel. And she was so excited about doing these experiments. And so it was a bright sunny day. She woke up. Oh, it's a cloudless day. I'm gonna do some of my distillation experiments. And so what did she do? She immediately ran to the store. And she rushed in, and she went to where they sell beer. And she was looking, and she was kind of talking to herself, and she said, I've got to find the strongest beer I can possibly find. And so then someone came up to her and said, young lady, can I help you? She says, I'm looking for the absolutely strongest beer that you sell here. And he said, young lady, whatever your problems are, that is not the answer. So what would happen if we actually make bioethanol? As I mentioned, in Brazil they use sugarcane, in the US they use corn. There's obviously lots of ethical questions about using things that humans can consume to put in your gas tank, so that's an important conversation to have. But then you ferment to make beer, and then you can distill. You could use a solar distillation to then produce pure ethanol. But let's get greedy, okay? Why should we actually use those feedstocks? People have been talking about this cellulosic ethanol for like 20 years. Okay, could you use wood, or could you use grass, right, just out in the field? You know, something that has very, very limited value. And then could you make ethanol out of it? Well, it's got sugar in there, but the sugar's trapped in the lignin. It's trapped in the stems. So we could also use solar steam. It's just like overcooking your vegetables. You know, if you really cook your vegetables way more than they should be, and then you drink the water's sweet. Because all the sugar, the starch is broken down, and all the sugar is left in the is left in the supernatant, right? And so we should be able to basically combine these two processes into basically sort of three processes where we steam our grass or our hay, and then ferment it, and then distill it. And so, like any good research group, we of course have a graduate student in our research group who makes beer. So he knew everything about how to do the right kind of fermentation. We basically just went out to the grocery store and bought simple yeast. We didn't use bioengineered yeast, so we just used the simplest thing as possible. And so we built all these steps. So the first step is to overcook our feedstock, our hay, and then to ferment it, and then to distill it, all using sunlight from start to finish. So I'm not going to get into the details of this, but grass is not optimized. Like, this is we're looking for glucose. There's lots of other things in grass. If we compare it to sugarcane is optimized. It has a lot of glucose, so this is a lot of other stuff. But we can at least but it's there, right? And so we can actually look at how we could extract it. We compare this to sugarcane, because if we can't do this process with sugarcane, we shouldn't even try doing this with grass. So we of course can buy some sugarcane, and we go through the whole process. And we do all the steps, fermentation and distillation, and we get out a lot more ethanol for with sugarcane than with hay. That doesn't surprise us at all. But basically, both processes are shown start to finish absolutely off grid. Right? You could do them in the middle of the wilderness, and you could go from grass to ethanol very easily. So another aspect where distillation is really important has to do with a problem that I'm sure most of you know about, and that is the fact that there's not enough drinkable water on the planet, either for human population, and it's compounded by the fact that there's lots of nasty industries that make water, wastewater, and don't really know what to do with it. They spend a lot of money trying to figure out what to do with it. And if you look at sort of the global equation about this, then you realize that all this wonderful water out in the ocean, of course, can't be accessed until you actually look through all of the different ways in which this gets used, and you find very, very little water that's actually available. And the problem with this is, as I said in the case of the other process, that that there's a huge energy cost if we want to use ocean water, for example, for drinking water. 50% of the cost of all desalination plants is the energy needed for operation. So as we're talking about making more fresh water for people, we actually are talking about increasing our carbon footprint because we're using so much energy to actually make that water in order for people to drink. So something that is off-grid that would actually produce fresh water is something that we'd be really interested in. So people who do water treatment, they've been looking at this for quite some time, and they have two processes, reverse osmosis. It doesn't work very well for salt water. You're very, very limited with reverse osmosis. The more saltier your water is, the harder, the more energy you have to put into the system. So it's really not good for desalination, although it's used. But there's this process called membrane distillation, where you have a porous membrane and you have two flows. So you start with salt water, and you heat it. Okay, so all of a sudden there's a huge energy cost. And you make a delta T between the heated input water and the actual distillate water. This delta T establishes a vapor pressure difference. And so when the water flows across the membrane, it actually converts to vapor through the membrane and recondenses on this other side of the membrane. And so the desalination works really very nicely. But the problem is this. The problem is you have to heat all of your input water. And so it's very energy intensive. And so we thought, well, why don't we convert this into a solar process, just like I showed you before, but now we're doing this on a membrane. So we put the light-absorbing nanoparticles, in this case we use carbon black, and we convert the membrane into a photothermal membrane, right? So we irradiate through a window onto the membrane, and then this is what, just this local heating here inside the membrane, induces, at least it wasn't my mother-in-law, induces a vaporization, and then it condenses here. And we can do this without any delta T. We don't have to heat the input water at all. We have everything's at the same temperature. And so so we try this. So we use carbon black. It matches the solar spectrum well enough that it works very well and is very, very cheap. Can be incorporated into our membrane. And so we figure out how to take a membrane and make it an optically absorbing. And we're using all of our understanding about photon statistics and about absorber scatterers, we optimize how much light gets absorbed in this region within this absorbing scattering coating here, and we use that as input for our membrane to optimize the light delivery in the region of the membrane where it's going to do the most work. And then we have this wonderful Italian postdoc who is able to basically take every single module of a COMSOL from Maxwell's equations using our Monte Carlo input to solving also the fluid dynamics, thermal transport, and mass transfer in order to describe this very complicated process quite accurately. And then, of course, we build it. So we build the structure. So this is a map. This is just the way it looks. It's a tiny little window because it's just a simple experiment. It's not meant for prime time. We put the whole thing in a box for insulation, and then we focus light onto the window, and we see very, very nice solar. I'm not going to go into any of the details here, but I'll just show you once we actually have focused sunlight, we have a very, very nice agreement with experiment. We're actually able to produce with basically no energy, just a simple solar pump, and you can actually use foot pump if you wanted to drive the water through this process. And the thing that's interesting about this process is compared to membrane distillation that I showed you, where you start with a delta T, where you start at the input is the highest efficiency, and everything goes downhill from there because the delta T gets smaller and smaller. But when you light from when you put sunlight on it, and you start with a delta T of zero, but right away as the water flows, the delta T gets larger and larger. And so actually the process scales up with increasing size, where membrane distillation goes down with increasing size. So membrane distillation is a dead end. It'll never work. But this process actually looks really quite quite promising. And while our experiment's way over here, we hadn't yet really exploited the fact that for larger areas, that's something that is going to work really very nicely. So what we're making is something that's like a solar panel, solar panels for electricity. This is a distillation panel. And if we go through the numbers, we can actually, so a desalination panel with one square meter, okay, can actually produce drinking water for, three is a little higher estimate, but it's about two people per day, their daily use of drinking water. Without any fuel input. No, you would just need just a solar pump, so no fossil fuels, basically. with focusing, this actually would go up by about a factor of 7, so this number is maybe a little bit higher, 15 or so. So this is actually very exciting if we think about it, that we actually could think about building a very simple type of panel that would actually begin to process clean water in remote locations or places where we don't have to plug into the grid and actually provide things for people. So plasmonics is a big field, and I haven't talked about a lot of other things, which I certainly don't have the time to, but just want to mention that within the context of plasmons and combining metallic nanoparticles, you can see some beautifully rich physics like coherent phenomena. For example, this is a phonoresonance that you can make with nanoparticle clusters. For chemists, there's lots of wonderful opportunities for detecting molecules, either using different types of aptamers and their optical signature, for using surface-enhanced Raman spectroscopy down to the single molecule level. You can actually, when a plasmon decays, it generates a hot electron. That hot electron can actually be used to drive new types of photodetectors. I mentioned photothermal cancer therapy. There's lots of other very interesting applications involving things like drug delivery that are of a lot of interest, where plasmonics can play an important role. And as I just described to you, light harvesting for solar energy, something that we're very excited about for direct solar energy, not for photovoltaics. People are working hard on photovoltaics and making wonderful progress, but we're looking at this for something where we're using light energy much more efficiently than we ever could if we started with solar energy and then did the conventional approach. So with that, I want to mention. So we talked about plasmonic nanoparticles and light scattering, collective light scattering, how we can use that for heating, and how that's remarkably related to cancer therapy, and how we can also use the same effect for new ways to use sunlight to make clean water for people, for folks. So I have a lot of wonderful collaborators, and this list is not updated. I apologize for that, but this picture is a pretty recent one. These are my wonderful students, who are from physics and chemistry and applied physics, electrical engineering and bioengineering, and even these days civil engineering. I think we let a civil engineer in. So we have a lot of wonderful, great ideas that come out of these guys. And one I mentioned earlier, Aura, who is the champion of our solar steam effort. So she actually took our solar steam one of our first generation solar steam apparatus, and she took it to Seattle to meet this guy. I don't know if you recognize that guy. He, as I mentioned him earlier, and she was also she was really happy to meet him. She came up to me afterwards and she said, "That guy, he came up to me and he asked such wonderful questions. Who was that guy?" So with that, I want to thank you very much for your attention. I'm more than happy to answer any questions. That's a really good question. You don't exactly know what they are. This is one of our, in any of those contexts, you're flying blind, right? You can't put an accurate number of nanoparticles into a tumor. So that's why the so part of this is, of course, operational or empirical, but that's also why the light delivery strategy is done in a very comprehensive way, so that you can access all parts of the tumor uniformly.
as conventional methods does?
That's a wonderful question. So this is why we started to use carbon black, because carbon black is something that is very inexpensive, has been mass produced for more than 100 years. So if you have ever used ink or asphalt, that's the black in newspaper, newsprint. So it's a pigment that's, I think it's also the black in tattoos. So that's usually made by burning organic matter in a furnace or an oven. It's actually made in many, many different countries. So because it's made with very, very inexpensive feedstock. So you're just burning some organic, like corn cobs, for example, burn organic matter up to a certain temperature. So you're right to always think about that. But if you're going to use a nanoparticle solution, this is undoubtedly by far the cheapest way to do it. It's sold by the ton. It's a commodity. It has some very elegant physics associated with it too, but I'm not going to go there right now.
Okay. Next question, please.
So in conjunction with the previous question, I'd like to ask how does carbon black differ from just simply coloring your water, making it appear darker?
Say what you said. I didn't. How does carbon black?
As I understand, that solar vapor generation with silver or gold nanoparticles involves like Sample's monic effects. Yeah.
It involves being a strong absorber or absorber scatterer. So anything that falls into that same category. So one part, maybe one thing you're asking there is carbon black plasmonic? The question is, we actually don't know whether or not that's a plasmon or not. We know it's a very strong absorber of light, and there's some interesting, very fundamental, interesting questions about the nature of carbon black as an optical absorber. It's actually it's very, very close. It's sort of in the same family as graphene, so it's very likely that there is a plasmon, but that's not something that has been officially confirmed at this point.
So the question is,
you couldn't use something, so it would be much, much less efficient to use something like a quantum dot, for example, because you have one photon in, one photon out, right? You have making an excited state, and then you're cycling in one photon at a time. If you think about a plasmon is exciting, so if you have 10,000 electrons in a metal particle, then you're exciting 10,000 electrons. This cross-section of the particle goes as the number of electrons in the particle. So the cross-section is orders of magnitude larger than, say, a dye molecule or a quantum dot. And the example of that actually is the pregnancy test that I showed you earlier, that how much more vibrant and how much stronger a metal nanoparticle will interact with light than something like a molecule or a quantum dot.
About the stability of your nanoparticles, especially for the animal experiments, and for this, because it's for clinics, I think it's very.
They're extremely stable. The company had to do 5 years worth of research, really extensive research, to study biological effects in large animals and in many different contexts. And the result is the most boring paper you've ever read, because there is they actually dosed animals to 20 times dosed animals to 20 times the human dose, and what they saw was a small discoloration of the liver that went away. So there was so they actually just never saw any problem with that.
Finally, for the solar cells, it's possible to use only one cell for like 20 years, something like this. So it's, if we buy for another country, it's stable, and we don't need to change the nanoparticles in the cells.
Well, from what we've seen, we've done this in several different contexts. In the first distillation work that we did, we actually put the particles in the water, and then we put the water vessel at the at the focus of a parabola, right, a parabolic reflector, and there, and we would produce steam, but then we would lose our liquid, and so we use a foot pump to then put the liquid back in there. They stay, they don't get conveyed in the vapor, and we actually had them, we've had them there since about 2012, I think, was when we actually built that setup. So they've been there for a very long period of time, and we've actually had undergraduates working on them, so they did horrible things to that system, where they had backflow of filthy water into that system. So what happens is, over time, the nanoparticles will fall out of solution, but then as soon as you illuminate them, then they through convection, they get heated up again.
Is it possible to use nanoparticles only on specific tumors in one place, or it would work even in leukemia case?
That's a wonderful question, and this has to do with a lot with how one develops a technology. Okay, in this case, the nanoparticles have no antibodies or no targeting molecule. Okay, and that means they're not a drug, and so the Food and Drug Administration, the governmental body that would approve this, looks at them as a device that is not a drug. Special device, because it's a nanoscale device, but it's not delivering a drug. And so that actually is a much more straightforward process for approval than if we just put an antibody on it. That would convert it legally into something that was a chemical. But in principle, yes. I mean, in principle, that would be exactly how you know, there's a lot of interest, and we certainly have done in the research lab, we've looked at how you can target certain cell lines with different types of antibodies or aptamers. Thank you. You get two.
Question about therapy. What happens with tumor when it decomposes? So the matter has to go somewhere. So does it immunological response or some toxicity maybe?
No. So when cells are lysed, so we have cells dying in our body all the time. And so we have lots of mechanisms, lots of enzymes that then will recognize. We have cells, right, that are basically the garbage collectors, and go through the bloodstream, and they take any kind of fragment that they can detect, and they internalize it. So through phagocytosis, right, and so. That's usually not, that mechanism is works for this as well. So you're probably thinking about metastatic disease, whether you're destroying this tumor, and then will this then release cells that will then go off and form cancer elsewhere. That's a very interesting and important question, and it's probably in many ways it's probably unanswered. But people know a lot about the pathology of metastatic disease now, and they're also they're beginning to believe that even at the very earliest stages of tumor formation, even before a tumor is when it's much smaller than something that could actually be recognized by us, that also already the seeds to metastatic disease are moving into are located in other organs of the body, and they just need some sort of a switch to turn on in order to grow. So there's sort of an old conventional model that a tumor has to be very large, and then at a mature state it releases metastatic disease, and people no longer believe that is the case. So metastatic disease is of course a really important problem. This does not directly address it, but things like targeting that were mentioned earlier, those are certainly processes that could address it. No, in fact, that's an interesting problem. But because the particles are about 100 nanometers or so in diameter within this application, they are removed through the kidneys. I'm sorry, I said that wrong. They're moved through the liver, not the kidneys. So they have, there's no kidney toxicity associated with nanoparticles. They're removed through the process of the liver within sort of a kind of a time scale of about 6 to 8 weeks. So it's longer than sort of conventional drug, but they avoid the route that often often causes toxicity, and that is entrance into the kidneys and destroying of that tissue. I'm sorry?
So nanoparticles dissolve practically into gold molecules?
No, actually they don't decompose. So they're taken up and they're released through the solid matter. So I don't have to say that. Although I talked about that already in a different context. But they so they leave the body intact.
Okay, and very 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 last question if somebody has. So if there are no questions. Thank you, Naomi, for great discussion.
Thank you.